Yes, I would like to share my experience today with you. So originally I was coming out from the guided drill protocol. So it was since I performed since 2004. So my experience there was from the very beginning that it's much easier to achieve primary implant stability in the guided drill protocol. And I think one reason for that is that you don't have deviations or angulation due to the guidance of the templates and of the sleeve. So looking at conventional drill protocols on the other side, we see that deviations or angulations are happening with every drill step. And in other words, this means that with an increased number of drills, these number of deviations will add up. And at the end, we have a compromised drill hole quality, mostly larger than expected, and consequently, we have a loss of primary implant stability. And a drill protocol like that, I would say, it's something like we waste the bone. So going back to the development period, and it really was for me an honor and was very excited to be part of this development team. So thank you very much to be part of this team, to all of us. And we really had exciting work, and we went, initially we tested all the new components in bone models. And later we went to Vienna to perform the procedure under conditions more closer to our daily routine. And we went to the cadaver lab in Vienna, your city. And we performed all indications of implant site preparation, heel site, upper jaw, lower jaw, and extraction socket, immediate implant placement. And our findings were discussed side by side, directly on site with the engineers and the whole development teams. And the findings were directly implemented in the next development of the osteoshaper or the osteodirector. So the aim was to create an implant site preparation which was minimally invasive, following the biological aspects of Jill and John, being less traumatic for the patients and really less complex for us, the clinician, to use. So finally, we go to the, I choose a case from the upper jaw, and I decided to go for flapless surgery and started a Nobel clinician planning. So, we went first for the template and the guided surgery approach with the 2 millimeter drill. And as you see, the positioning of the two implants are close to the palate and very close to the sinus. So, the first drill was a 2 millimeter guided drill, as you all know, and a tissue punch. And then we went through the osteodirector. And like Odette and Sasha already mentioned, the osteodirector is the one who's making the direction. The osteoshaper is following, and the implant is following as well. So let's have a look at the osteoshaper, who's performing. And you see that the osteoshaper is easily engaging the osteotomy, smoothly and passively following the osteotomy. And now we are coming back, looking at conventional drill protocols. The tip of the osteoshaper is not cutting, and that means it's just following without deviations. And the result is not, it's much better drill hole than in conventional drill procedures. We do not waste our bone. So having a look at another case, we have a single tooth replacement, and the bone quality was in this case to 3 to 4. And the biggest advantage is, even if you know as an experienced surgeon about the bone quality, you do not have to in this protocol, because the protocol leads you to implant placement. You go down with the osteodirector and the osteoshaper, and because you can fully see the osteoshaper, you know that you can proper place your implant and you will reach primary implant stability. Here's the visibility of the engagement very nicely, and then you see that in this bone quality of 4, the osteoshaper is not bringing up as much bone chips as before. And we'll see in the movie right now. So the performance of the osteoshaper is without pressure to my handpiece, without pushing or pulling like we are used to, without irrigation, which is extremely important for flapless surgery because this increases visibility. So at the end, to summarize, we see the osteoshapers and the different amount of bone. So what we are having, we do not have a waste of bone. We the bone is staying in the osteotomy and it's allowing us to go for immediate implant placement with predictable primary implant stability. We see the osteodirector again and the osteoshaper, and now we are coming to the implant. And you all heard the slogan of Nobel Biocare these days, we follow no one. And when I arrived here and I saw the slogan, I was laughing, and I would like to make a small modification of that. It's completely right, you follow no one except the osteodirector, because the osteodirector is the key to success of this protocol, and the implant and the osteoshaper, they share the same macro shape. So that's why the behaving of the implant surgically is really similar to the osteoshaper. The implant itself is easy engaging to the osteotomy and is easy following the osteotomy like the osteoshaper did before. So we see here in this flap procedure that it's really easy due to less no irrigation to see the lines on the implant driver, and it's an easy pickup of the implant and an easy installation of the implant. So on the implant driver, there's a flat part where you can see to do the orientation of your implant when you're going for flapless surgery. In case you want to, you can finalize later on with the torque wrench, but normally I do the performance only with the machine torque. So here you can see the orientation of the flat side as we saw before from the presentation of Jill and John, that the flat part of the triangle shape should be orientated to the buckle to give bone and the soft tissue more space. We went for the installation of multi-unit abutments and later on for healing caps, and that was the final then. So here's the final X-ray, and as you can see, we've been really close to the sinus. It seems from this kind of X-ray to be in the sinus with the posterior implants. It's not. It's like exactly it was in the Nobel clinician planning, close to the implant positioned on the palate, and the implant is perfect for that, because the tip of the implant is not self-cutting. That means that the risk of perforation, the sinus membrane, is reduced. So going back to our other case, the single tooth restoration, and we have again direct shape and place. And here we can see that the implant is engaging to the osteotomy. It's running, yes. So the implant is engaging to the osteotomy, and I really have control. I feel that I'm in the right position. And then the implant is following smoothly the osteotomy, and you see the hydrophilicity of the surface, and the blood is coming up on that new tiunite surface. So there were a lot of groups working together, one group only for the surface, so to make this implant really unique at all. We had primary implant stability in the cases, even in the case like that, and so we decided to go for immediate provisionalization, mounted the base and a temporary abutment and a kind of tam shell, and later on that was the way the patient left the office, and we have the result later on, 10 days later, before we put off the stitches and the provisionalization later on. So we performed all cases of implant indications. We had heel side, upper jaw, lower jaw, extraction sockets, combination with bone graft, sinus elevation. So, and it was, for me, extremely necessary to point out that's not an implant on top for an additional indication. It's really an implant I can perform all my cases. So Odette, you will show us later on further indications and going more in detail to the indications with bone augmentations. So that was a case where we started and we go for extraction of the teeth, and even in those compromised cases, we were able to go for immediate loading. There was a Nobel clinician planning before, and that was the picture after 10 days before putting off the stitches, and that's the way later on the provisionalization same day, but that's where after putting up the stitches where the patient left the office. So we have, I started with all indications 2 years ago. And so we're starting for sure with the simple cases like heel side and then going to extraction socket, immediate implant placement, provisionalization and all indications. And so I want to share my experience of follow-up this year. So that was a 18 months follow-up. So we have very nice stable tissue and nice bone attitudes, so no bone loss at all. And even in complex cases like those ones where we went for extraction, immediate implant placement, extraction of the all the teeth in the upper jaw, immediate implant placement, bone grafting, immediate provisionalization and finalization, and that's the 18 months follow-up and the radiographic detail.